Something about a boat sitting on the sea, out there in the wind, floating on the free. Take around the world, bring you back home.
Okay, my name is Jack Grunstrom. I'm a shellfish commissioner in the town of Raleigh. We lay down the laws as to what should and shouldn't be done in the clam flats. I was the shellfish constable in town who enforces the laws for about 10 years until this past year when my son took over the job. I'm a third generation clam digger in Raleigh. Both of my grandfathers dug clams, my father dug clams. I've spent most of my life around the clam industry, digging, shocking, running a shocking house, whatever it took. So I feel that I pretty much know the clam industry. I know the river like the palm of my hand and love every inch of it, high tide or low tide. Okay, this is my identification. In case I go to talk to somebody downriver, that they will know who I am and know that I have authority to do so. On the other side of this, I have a gauge. The inside of the gauge is 2 inches, and that's the minimum size for soft shell clams. Going through this way is 1 inch, and that's the thickness for quahogs. If a quahog goes through there, it's not legal, it's too small. But if it won't go through there, that's the thickness. And this 3 inches is for oysters. So we have soft shell clams, quahogs, and oysters. And I can check any that they have in their buckets, and if they got more than 9% undersized, I can take them away from them. Now I'm gonna take you out in the river and give you a little history of the river. I'm gonna go in 2 trips, one at high tide and one at low tide, to show you the difference of what happens around here between the tides. The tides are about 6 hours from high to low and another 6 hours from low to high again. So we can plan on it day to day and plan to go clamming about an hour later each day, because that's what the tide will come, is about 40 minutes to an hour later. Today is about a 9-foot tide, which means that the high tide will be about 9 foot higher than the low tide. And I hope you enjoy the river as much as I have. We'll go upriver to the old sawmill. Our left side is Ipswich, and everything on our right side is Raleigh. And what you're looking at is the old warehouse. This part of the river is called Warehouse River. Actually, there's 3 sections. Way down at the end is Raleigh River, and then Warehouse River, and then we'll go up into what's called Egypt River. On our left is what used to be the old Ipswich Poor Farm. Anybody that couldn't afford to live on their own would live at the Poor Farm. They raised all of their own vegetables and all that sort of thing. And before the railroad came through, it came right out to the river here. So we were in very close contact with Ipswich right at this spot. You could practically walk across the river here at low tide. On the right is a big marsh island called Bradstreet's Island. Part of the Bradstreet Farm, an original grant from the King of England, and they used to use it to camp out there when they were down here marsh haying, I should say. But these marsh islands, they're the result of an outcropping in the marsh that starts catching dirt and bird messes and things like that, and eventually becomes a marsh island. There's a lot of them. There's little ones, big ones. This part of the river we're in right now, when it's low tide, you can definitely walk across here, and it's not navigable. But as you can see at high tide, it's quite navigable. There's probably 7 to 8 feet of water under us right now. And like I say, everything on the left is Ipswich, everything on the right is Raleigh. And as we go up, it's gonna be tough to discern because the river winds up here like a snake. And then as we get up here, I'll show you where there was a couple of old mills back in the 1700s. One was a lumber mill and the other was a grist mill where they ground up wheat and things like that for bread, corn. of our greenhead pots up there. Been big news the last few days. They didn't appropriate any money in Newbury to put out greenhead traps down at Plum Island. So a bunch of concerned citizens got together and raised enough money to put out the greenhead traps. Those greenhead traps, they trap thousands of greenhead flies during the summer. The greenheads like to go up under a cow's belly, and those are painted so that the greenheads think they're a cow. They go up underneath and get trapped up inside, and they just stay there and die a natural death. But I'm talking thousands of them. And it really does cut down on the greenhead fly population. For those that don't know what a greenhead fly is, they look like a big house fly, but they've got a green head and they take a wicked, wicked bite out here. They generally arrive on time on the 4th of July, just when you want to have your cookout, to about the 15th of August. When I was a kid, this was all harvested for the salt hay. And it was used mostly for bedding and for banking up houses, which you put around the foundations to keep the house warmer. The cows could eat it, it was nourishing, but you could really smell it in the milk. And right on your right is the lower end of a canal. At low tide, we'll see more of it. But that was a canal that was dug across the marsh to run a sawmill back in the 1750s. Coming up ahead is the end of the canal that I told you they cut through to run the sawmill up at the corner near Muddy Run. And they used to close this and then open it on the incoming tide so that the tide would get up behind the sawmill and then run out afterwards. But when the tide's out low, you can see the whole structure there. Most of it was gating, as you can see, and then right in the middle where the run is, there was a gate they could open and close there. All work by hand. No machinery down here. Two famous windmills that are in the town of Ipswich, and they generate a good deal of electricity from them. On the left is where Muddy Run comes out of Ipswich. That goes across Route 1A and it picks up in behind the Dairy Queen in Ipswich, and it comes all the way out through and joins here. And from this point on, the river, because it's all in Ipswich, is called Egypt River. The early settlers, they saw these reeds along the sides and they thought they were like bulrushes from the Moses story. You notice the beautiful reflections in the water? Janet, I just appreciate those so much. Looks like you're going down 100 feet there into the depth. Okay, this is the corner of Muddy Run and where Egypt River starts. The entrance that you're looking at straight ahead is the entrance, that's Muddy Run to your left and the entrance to Egypt River here on your right. Now right here in this corner is where that tidal sawmill was around 1750. It only operated for about a year and burned down. But all down underneath us here is all huge planks from the sawmill that was here, like I say, in 1750. But I can see where a sawmill might tend to burn down. The entrance to it was from Ipswich, down Paradise Road in Ipswich. And then they loaded this bank here, that's where they loaded all the lumber down over it and put it through the sawmill and then haul the cut lumber away again. But this timber here has been in the water, like I say, since 1750, so old, old stuff. This is the type of bulrush that they saw, thought they were in Egypt. Not real.
Straight down the Mississippi.
another marsh island here, do all of their work, like maybe putting new marsh shoes on the horses or anything like that up on those islands back in the day when they were, marsh hay was one of the big items that they had here in the early days. And up ahead here was the site of the Harris Grist Mill. If we go straight ahead, just before we get to that island. Jewett, who wrote the book on the history of Raleigh, talks about walking over from Ipswich with a peck of wheat and a peck of something else and having it ground up for the mill and walk it home so his mother could make biscuits for breakfast. So there was a different time in those days. Right where we are now was always considered Girls Creek. In the early times, there wasn't many places to have recreation, so swimming was a big thing. And the girls would come down to this area and do their thing, whatever it was. And up above, we'll go to where Boys Creek, where the boys came to swim. And right here is where the Harris Grist Mill was. It was a tidal mill operated on both tides, incoming and outgoing. And very successfully operated for 100 years. Now, if you walk up over the hill behind here, you'll be up on the hill right beside the Savage Farm. And Harris was an ancestor of the Savages. Because up ahead here a little ways, we're going to come to where Bull Brook begins. We see it over by the electric plant in Ipswich. It goes under Route 1A, and that's Bull Brook from there over to here. And that's the source of the Rowley River. And this is Boys Creek here. The boys used to come down here and swim. Again, I've never seen a bathing suit down here. And there's a road right behind here called Farms Lane that goes up and connects to the end of Hammond Street. Now that area we just passed that I call Boys Creek is also called Paradise. And this side of the Egypt River over here is also Paradise. And the early settlers thought it was so much like Paradise that it's always been that. You can again really see those reeds here that they love so much. And Paradise Road over in Ipswich that goes down across from the clam box that goes into the Ipswich Paradise, and Hammond Street in Raleigh goes into the Raleigh part of Paradise. This is about as far as we, well, we could go further, but this is right here is where Bull Brook begins. From here on in, that's Bull Brook. But you know deep down, I'm kind of tempted to go and see my fancy again. Cripple Creek, she sends me if I spring a leak. She makes me, I don't have to scream. She defends me, a drunkard's dream. If I ever did see one. The lumber mill was over and behind it. They found a Paleo Indian site 12,000 years ago, and they brought up thousands of artifacts. It was probably the biggest Paleo site in New England, and all of the artifacts are in the Peabody Essex Museum. At that time, the sea level was below what it is now. So they think that the antelope and whatnot used to come down out of the mountains and go out onto the plain, which is now all covered by water. And these guys would harvest them on their way in and out from that. But it was a huge Paleo-Indian site. The one bad thing that happened about 50 years ago, well, a group of four guys from, I think, Lynn, called the Bull Brook Boys, they found the Paleo-Indian site, and they were amateur archaeologists. And they used to come there every chance they get and dig up artifacts. So like I say, they got thousands of them. And then somebody bought the land and turned it into a gravel pit. They gave the Bull Brook Boys just a certain amount of time, so they got some help and got out everything they could. But then the entire site was destroyed into a gravel pit. So that was kind of a loss, because it could have been a wonderful site. And this is exactly where Egypt River starts, where Muddy Run comes out from Ipswich here. Everything up past us, going upriver, is Egypt River, and everything ahead of us is Warehouse River. This is where Muddy Run comes out of Ipswich under the railroad tracks. And at about mid-tide on a fast-flowing tide, there's a beautiful whirlpool right here where we sit. And you can come up here with your boat and just sit and go and shut the engine off and go round and round and round and round. And you can swim off of there. The tides here run about 8 feet. The height of the water changes at low tide to high tide by about 8 feet. However, we get as high as 12-foot tides during the winter when we get the highest tides. And it goes around a center point, so it goes out 2 extra feet and comes in 2 extra feet. So it doesn't all add to the top. Some of it goes down from the bottom, but a 12-foot tide goes out 6 feet above the center and 6 feet below the center point. And an 8-foot tide comes in 4 feet above and goes out 4 feet below. The tides are caused by the moon, and primarily by the moon, but also other planets that might align. And they change by about 40 minutes a day. The high tide tomorrow will be about 40 minutes later than it is today, and the low tide will be about 40 minutes later. However, that's not an exact thing. Like, I have a tide watch that operates on a 40-minute hour. On some days, on a normal medium tide, it's right on the button, and as it gets higher and lower, it may vary by 15 to 20 minutes, but it's generally about 40 minutes a day. Each day, 40 minutes later than the day previous. And when there's a real high tide, the water comes rushing in here in torrents. When there's a low tide, it kind of creeps in a little bit. This is all private land on our left. This is down behind the Bradstreet Farm. Rowley now owns this right here on our left. When we purchased the Bradstreet Farm, we purchased, I think it's about a mile of riverfront. And then the Todd Farm sets up there. I don't think they own any riverfront at all. But all this land on the Rowley side is private land, generally to the original, like, savages at the end of Hammond Street owned most of the riverfront upriver where we were this morning. I have no idea who owns the Ipswich side, but it's never been built on in my memory.
Down to my boat on the river, and I won't cry out anymore. Oh, the river is deep, the river
also part of Pearly's Marina over on the right here. They expanded across the river, put electricity over there and all that. Shining through the trees. Crickets are singing and lightning bugs are floating on the breeze. Baby, get ready. Across the field where the creek turns back by the old stump road. I love your Carolina skills.
Isn't that nice?
You gotta love them. That's Chris Pearly, who owns the Pearly's Marina down here. I think the amount of boats here might amaze a lot of people. Like I say, this is all oysters under here. But above the bridge, by agreement with the state, because of the marina here and the possibility of some spills, this area is closed to shellfish during the summer while the marina's operating. But in the fall and winter, it's a great spot to get some oysters. Well, the marina's been here at least 100 years. Pearly's probably owned it for the last 25 or something like that. Russell or Rut Worthley owned it for years. He didn't run many small boats out of here. It was generally big boats at that time, 25 to 35 feet, and they used to get out and spend the weekends down to Sandy Point and things like that. The wharf there was built by herring fishermen. There was a big business here back in the 40s and 50s on fishing herring at night. But that was a big activity down here at the time. But years ago, when we had probably 15 or 20 boats here, every engineer and every conductor knew every boat around here. They'll always come by and do it, and they'll always come into the station down there and say, "Rowley, Rowley, home of the brick battleships." Just jiving us, you know. When they brought the railroad back to, Bill DeMento talked them into raising this about 6 inches to give us more headroom for the bigger boats coming out of here, and they did it. Get on the river, you will see these markers. That's a slow marker, and directly ahead of us is a channel marker, and it's green. And when you're going downriver, green is on your right, and red is on your left. But returning, it's red on your right, returning. So, and you better remember that, because it's sometimes you go to the wrong side of the marker and you're hard up on some rocks. The old Ipswich Poor Farm is on our right, and in the early days, the American Indians lived there. And every time I come by here, I can just picture them coming out on here with spears, spearing fish in this river when it was very, very plentiful here. They had all kinds of fish. They had clams, they had lobsters, plenty of lobsters, and oysters right at their fingertips here. And they used to plant corn up there in single hills with a fish under each hill of corn for fertilizer. And I'm sure they got the fish very easy, and they got wonderful growth. Look at this banking here, right to your right here. Look at how it reflects down into the water. Isn't that amazing? Looks like it goes down deep, 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 deep. I'm always fascinated. When there's clear water, it's like a mirror there. At the end of Railroad Avenue that you see right there across the railroad tracks. It's an old, old settlement. It was originally called the Railroad Workers Housing. And there were about five houses there and the railroad workers worked there because if they worked in Boston, they could go right across the tracks and take the train to Boston, so it was very convenient for railroad workers. This was Johnson's Landing here, right beside that camp, and there used to be a road come right out there and a wharf there where they could launch boats and load boats, party boats going down river, and the one that comes into us right ahead was Bachelor's Landing. Ruth Alexander's father built that, this whole settlement, and that, called the Birdhouse, was built by Ruth Alexander and her husband. They lived there for the final years of their life. There's a very shallow spot here where there's rocks. They came down, I'm going to say, 50 years ago and blasted them at the insistence of the town fathers. Then they didn't remove them, they left them all there. So I'm always very careful right in this spot. Anybody that loves bird life, this is the place for it. And as we get further and further into summer, the more and more birds we get down here. That little creek there we always call Columbus Avenue. Oyster Point is up at the other end of it, and there was a gentleman who was part Native American who lived there, and his name was Columbus Arthur. And we always call that Columbus Avenue because that was the road up to his house. This is a great clam flat over on your right. That's all Ipswich clam flat over there. A lot of it, good clamming. You may see some, no, you won't see any diggers today because the flats are closed. See you tomorrow. As far as the flat closure goes, we have an agreement with the state that if we read our gauges every morning at 5 a.m. And if we get more than a half an inch during the summer, we close the flats for 5 days. This is Newbury, Ipswich, and Rowley. And if we get over an inch, we close them for 8 days. Coming into the winter, they relieve that so that there's no half-inch closer. There's no one-inch closer at all. It's just a half-inch closer at an inch. So it's a little different winter and summer. But we've had 2 weeks that we've been closed now because we've had consistent rain just about for the 2 weeks. It's a double-edged spear because the guys can't go digging. However, it's good propagation for the flats and allows them to get a little bit of a rest. Because if they could dig every day, they were what we call hammer the flats. So it's a double-edged spear. It's a good propagation tool also. However, when it happens in the week before the 4th of July and the week after, when the clams are most desired and at the highest price, it doesn't make the clammers happy at all. And when we say the left bank is Rowley and the right bank is Ipswich, that's to the center of the channel. As you can see, we're going to come around the corner here and the channel is going to be right against the bank. So that big flat that comes out in the middle of the river called the Whaleback, that's all Ipswich. And the channel's quite narrow here, too. So this is right smack in the middle of the river. This camp on the left was called the Brook House. It's been there for well over 100 years. There was always a legend around town that the first telephone conversation was between Alexander Graham Bell and a friend of his up on the end of Railroad Avenue. And I think probably the first telephone conversation in Rowley, not in the world.
No windy smiles, no walk down the aisle, no flowers.
lump on the left belongs to Bobby at Salt Marsh Antiques. He spends a lot of time there during the summer whenever he can break away from his business. At one time, this whole marsh was covered with ants like that. I'm going to guess more than 50, probably less than 100. But as they got destroyed during hurricanes and winter storms, they didn't rebuild them. Now they're not allowed to rebuild them. Talking about the channel being the river marker, right here, 20 years ago, you had to go to the right of this marsh island. You couldn't get through the channel. Now, you have to go to the left. There's plenty of water here, and you can't get through that channel. So theoretically, by our theory, that marsh island would now belong to Ipswich. However, it's on our assessor's map, so even though the channel changed, the island is still on our assessor's map. That doesn't change. That's what we do for propagation. We put out nets, and it captures small clams swimming, actually, in the water. And it goes down through the net to protect it from the clams. So when we pull them up, probably in another 2 to 3 weeks, it'll all be a lot of clams underneath there. And the way we propagate with it is, those clams, once they get to be an inch and a half, will throw a lot of spawn that'll go up and down the river. What we call capture predator exclusion nets. They're very special. And it will probably tend to throw a lot of clams up into this creek here, which is West Creek. That's a public propagation project, as opposed to private. We call this area the nursery because we found it was the very best place to capture and raise small clams. When we started out with the netting project, we got 72 nets, and we put them in 36 different locations with two in each location to find out where it would work best. And this is where it worked the very best. This is another public propagation program. And those nets will probably be lifted before the end of summer. Once the clams get to be about an inch and a half and they've thrown a set of seed, we can lift the nets. Spear bird here is a loon. They swim underwater and dive and catch fish underwater. We got a lot of loons, and the little white one that stayed there, I think that's a seagull, they know where to come to looking for clams. Okay, this flat on our left is all private propagation. There's 4, 5, 6, 7 people who lease out from the town an acre apiece on here to do private propagation. They capture the clams, they protect the clams, and then when the clams are ready, they dig them and they profit from them. They do one spot 1 year and then one spot the next year and keep moving them around. But these clams, even though it's private propagation, they also throw clam seed all over the river and probably further than that. My son also raises oysters and quahogs on his acre. Those orange balls tell the boaters and others that it's a propagation area and to steer clear of it. This is the shallowest spot in the river here. I'm left over here, these were very famous islands in the early days. That first one, the one you're looking at right now, is Potato Island. I don't know why they call it Potato Island, but the next one down was Spring Island. I know why they call that Spring Island. And then the third one down was Hog Island. In the early days, the town of Raleigh deeded the whole of Hog Island over to the Native Americans to raise crops and fish and fowl and dig clams and do lobster and that type of thing. But it was a very busy, busy area. And all of this marsh that you see now was all cut for salt hay, every bit of it. Salt hay was a huge industry back then. I want to show you something interesting over here. I'm going to pull in. See all those white clams? I've sent some of these to the state biologist to analyze to see if he can determine the age of them. But these just started appearing about 20 years ago, just the tips of them. The mud around them is eroding to make them appear. I think they're very ancient clams, and either the marsh grew over them and smothered them, or we had a lot of rain, a lot, like a flood. And we got what they call a freshet. These can only stand a certain specific gravity of salt water. If it gets below that, down into fresh water, it kills them. But there's just millions of them here that died out all at once. They're all just about the same size, and it was a beautiful bed of clams. But I suspect it was the marsh grew out over them. The marsh has since receded, and now the land is scrubbing away between the shells, and these appeared about 20 years ago. Okay, that's Ipswich private propagation. This is the first year they've ever done it, and I think they got 4 or 5 people that are doing it. And again, like our flats, they're gonna grow clams under there. They're gonna throw spat, which is a little clam seed, and it's gonna go all over the river. It will not select just Ipswich flat. So it's an excellent propagation for both Ipswich and Raleigh. Okay, this is where we leave the Raleigh River and enter Plum Island Sound. Now the Raleigh River, the Parker River, Plum Island River, way up the other end, comes through from the Merrimack, and the Ipswich River and Eagle Hill River all dump into this Plum Island Sound. And then where you see straight ahead, it all runs out into Ipswich Bay. This navigational aid over here on the right, it's got a solar light on the top, and it charges up all day, and then at sunset, it starts blinking. So you can come in from way out into the ocean there and spot that and know where our Raleigh River is. Okay, this is Hog Island Point, and this is a brand new area that we just opened for private propagation last year. There's seven people who have leased out an acre apiece here, and then dead ahead, we've got oysters being raised in those cars, the yellow cars right ahead of us. That's Ben Savage and Danny Knight are in it together, and they're raising oysters in the water. They have what is called a subtidal site. The water never goes off it, so they're raising oysters in those floating cars. But the big thing about raising your own, like these oysters these guys are raising, they can raise all they want. They can gather them when the price is the very best and as many as they want and take them to market and be profitable on them. When you do wild oysters, you can only do 8. See, we do not allow commercial harvest of wild oysters here in Raleigh, only for home use, and that's 18 for each tide that you have that you can go down river on. But these guys can raise as many as they want and harvest them whenever they want. Rowley has 300 acres of flats. We can only propagate 100 acres. The refuge will not let us put these nets on their areas because they claim we might catch a bird of them. We've been doing this down here for 10 years now, and we have never, never, never caught a bird in a net. We told them that we would do a program and let them approve it, and if it didn't catch nets, could we do it? And they said no. They were told right from the beginning, never let us do it. So, but this is what we do on the flats we can do it on. 100 acres of three. A lot of hard work, but the guys love to do it, and they generally do it in their spare time. To sell clam, you have to lived in Rowley at least 1 year, and then you can apply from February 15th to March 30th to get a commercial permit for that coming year, and it costs $400. Then you have to go to the state and get a so-called state permit, which gives you a transaction card along with it, which is like a credit card. You can dig clams down here in any of the open flats when the flats are open. If they're not closed due to a rain closure or red tide, which we haven't seen for quite a few years now, and take them to, we have two authorized shellfish dealers in Rowley. One is Savage at the end of Hammond Street, and the other is Nealon up in the middle of Weathersfield Street. There are also Ipswich Shellfish, Ipswich Maritime, a lot of places in Ipswich that can buy your clams. You have to take them in, show them your transaction card, they run it through a machine, and you have to put a tag on the bag when you leave the flats, and that tag follows your clams all the way through to the final restaurant. So if there's any sort of problem with the quality of the clams, they can come back right to you as a digger and say, hey, where'd you dig these things? We didn't. If they're bad, you sure as heck didn't dig them in Rowley. You know what I'm saying? So that's how the thing is followed through. When digging is good and the market is good, generally in the middle of July, you get about $2 up to $3 a pound for the clams. But when the market isn't good, you get as low as $1 a pound, and sometimes even lower than that. So the price of the clam definitely depends on the market. And the funny part about clams is that the market depends on the amount of clams. Most places, your production depends on what your market demands. However, we have such a limited production, and we're trying to get it better and better, that's what the demand is based on, is what the production is. So if you can only produce 1,000 barrels of clams a year, they're only going to go to a certain area, locally here. If you could produce 10 times that much, it would spread out into 10 times the area, and you'd have exactly the same demand for the amount of clams you got. The first island on your right is Eagle Hill. Eagle Hill is the first one where all the camps are there. The next one is Great Neck, which is the biggest one of all, and then Little Neck. And then way out where you can see just the point of it there, that's Castle Hill, where ahead of you is Plum Island. That's all of the Plum Island Sound side of Plum Island. Just about a quarter of a mile over it is the Atlantic Ocean. Plum Island is like a protective barrier there for all of this inland stuff. And all the way as far as you can see, there's 9 miles of Plum Island. Rowley controls 1 mile of it. Ipswich controls the very lower point, then Rowley, 1 mile of it, and then Newbury controls a bit of it, and then Newburyport, the very upper end of it. And this green spot right out in the middle here is what's called the middle ground. And in the summertime, there'll be many, many picnickers out here at low tide, having cookouts and swimming and recreation, that type of thing. This area to the left, there was a restaurant, there was many cottages, there was two hotels actually at one time, and every Sunday afternoon they'd have baseball games there. They were almost like major leaguers now. They'd come from all over the place to watch the baseball games, and then everything started to fall apart. There was a mail boat that used to come out there all summer long out of Ipswich and deliver mail. And as things fell down, they didn't rebuild them. And then when the refuge came in, they didn't allow any rebuilding. So now there's only one cottage left here, and I'll show you where that is in a little bit. The name of it is Grape Island. I couldn't think of it, but now I've just thought of it. And on the right, that's Great Neck over there. See where the water tower is and all that? That's Great Neck. So we went past Eagle Hill, now Great Neck. This place here, this is the Bluffs. And Amber Hovey's family owned that for years. And it was a very, very, very popular place and a landmark. Even today, it's a landmark for people coming in from out to sea. They know they're in the right place when they see it. Beautiful, beautiful spot. It was scheduled to be torn down. It's on the refuge part now. It was scheduled to be torn down like everything else down here. But they've preserved it this far. And people should do everything they can to get it preserved because it is a real landmark for our area. It's a beautiful, beautiful place. Now down, if you pan down to the right, all of that was cottages. Sandy Point. And they all got torn down by the refuge. If you look at Castle Hill, you can see the flat spot there right out towards the end, and all the pictures show that. When Crane built the castle there, he had that flat spot cut, and you can look right from the castle up to the Isle of Shoals. He was enthralled by the Isle of Shoals, so that he could wake up in the morning and look right up, and if it was a clear weather, he could see the Isle of Shoals. Now that's Castle Hill. And then the white spot right directly ahead is called Steep Hill. Steep Hill is a very busy place. There's always 30 or 40 boats pulled up there with people enjoying the beach and whatnot. Then the Ipswich River, where you see Steep Hill, the sand spot, and then Little Neck, the Ipswich River goes up in between the two of them. Little Neck, that always was owned by the town. And leased, the land was leased out, and the people own the houses on it. But now they've just come to selling. It's been big news, selling the land to the people. And the indentation between Great Neck and Little Neck is Pavilion Beach. And there used to be a pavilion there where they'd hold dine and dances on Saturday night. Very, very popular place in the summer. And then from there, you're looking straight out to sea. And over there is the backside of Rockport. There you see way off in the distance there. Across Ipswich Bay. At the end of Cranes Beach, the Essex River goes in, up behind Essex. So that's about it. From here on in, you can go out past the end of Rockport and head to England if you'd like. Many, many, many ships have been wrecked right along this. This is the Ipswich Bar. It's very treacherous during any kind of storms at all. And many ships have been wrecked there. Merrimack, you've got some indication of where it is, but the Ipswich Bar, it shifts every year. And people think they're going to come in over it, and all of a sudden they ground out, and then they turn sideways and flip right upside down. Thank you. chimney sticking out of the roof. The hunters still come down here during hunting season. And when the tide is low, ducks come in, they settle into the creek, both on this little side creek and this big creek in front. Then they get up in the morning and they start popping ducks. But it's still used. And boy, many times when I've been digging and we had a tough rainstorm come up, I'd get up and get on that piazza and thought I was in the porch and think I was in heaven, you know. Just to get out of the rain. I gotta tell you a quick story. One day, my son and I and Dick Kent, who lives at the plantation, were up in here digging with a bunch of other guys. And it was nice weather. My son's phone rings. It's my wife. She says, "You better get home. There's a huge storm coming." So our boat was anchored way out past that last point. So my son, who was the youngest, he ran out to get the boat. And he got up in here. And by that time, we had a storm that was unbelievable. The tide was coming in, and there was so much rain, there was a tidal wave coming out. And Dick and I were standing there holding the boat so it wouldn't go floating out against the tide. And he threw the clams, and all of a sudden, all three of us jumped into the boat, and we went out of here like the Swiss Family Robinson on a tidal wave. It was unbelievable. Funniest thing I ever saw in my life. But here's the tide coming in, and we were going out fast. That's where they used to pile salt hay. They used to make big stacks on the top of those staddles. It was a bunch of generally cedar posts driven into the marsh, and it kept it up away from the water, you know, up above the ice and whatnot in the wintertime. So those are staddles. This is now owned by Woods Hole, and they lease it out to Greenbelt and places like that. They come up here and do studies. They use it as a field house to go down river and study different things. But Woods Hole, Ruth Alexander left the whole thing to Woods Hole. Almost everything down here is owned by either Greenbelt, Woods Hole, or Audubon. This is privately owned right here.
Something about a boat sitting on the sea, out there in the wind, floating on the free.
Those numbers on the piling tell you how much headroom you got going through.
Bring you back.
Don't tell you how much bottom room you got.
Gives a man.
But anytime you come up here in a low tide like this, and it's calm, you see what a beautiful sight it is.
Guitar, and the way it still
I've seen
sings.
It a thousand times, and I love to see it the next
After
time.
After all the smoky fog and the broken strings, played a million songs, broke a lot of hearts, made some people's hearts. Something about an old guitar. Ain't it crazy how something seems like nothing at all? Take a big old room, make it seem so small. Seeing windows where there are walls makes a whole lot of something or nothing at all. Something about your dog.
Coming into the home
just
port.
Just a wagging that tail, grinning that grin. Something
something about my dog. Makes her my best friend. Ain't it crazy how something seems like nothing at all? Take a big old room, make it seem
okay,
so
I hope
small.
You enjoyed this little ride as much as I have. Every ride I've taken over my lifetime. And if you've got any questions or you want further information about the Rowley River and what we do here, give me a call anytime, Jack Grunstrom, 978-948-2508, and we'll get together and talk. Thank you. Bye now.
Something about a dog, something about an old guitar, something about a boat gives a man hope.